near you since you left town. The club's closed down. There's one more burned out lamppost on Main Street. Down where we used to stroll. And near you, I still hit all the same old haunts. You follow me wherever I go. Near you, Saturday night in a petty arcade with your hair tied back and the diamond twinkles in your eyes. Only wedding.
Did we get it? Amen. Poet and artist interviews, poeTart, file number 15, take 15. Kurt Sorensen here in the studio. Day, Saturday the 14th of July, 2012. Kurt, great to see you.
Oh, au revoir. Is it nice?
We don't want to say goodbye to you, just yet. We won't say adieu, but we will say bonsoir, monsieur.
Bonsoir.
So, Kurt, photography is your craft. It is your art form. You do absolutely well-considered and well-researched work. Tell us about what it is that you do in your photography.
I take pictures. I'm basically a landscape photographer. That does sound right there. And from there, well, I grew up as a student of history, not in a tertiary sense, just, you know, liking reading about Europeans. The history of the colonial history of Australia. So, and trying to understand that from the perspective of a middle class white guy from the suburbs of Sydney, what that means, and the fact that the landscape where I grew up was very national park surrounded and very green, and I would always be quite fascinated by the bush, but you know, kind of, there was an unease there, and I never really thought about it too much until I started reading colonial histories and that whole idea of Europeans misunderstanding the landscape, and that really struck a chord with me, and just the whole hopelessness of the whiteys trying to, you know, get a handle on what was happening here. So I started researching a lot of stories that weren't necessarily very famous stories, but were just these strange kind of series happenings in the bush or in the landscape, in the Australian landscape, that would be reported in newspapers back in the 1800s. And then going to those places, it just started off as me trying to imagine those events, or what I thought those events would look like, and the landscape would look like. So I'd go there at the time that the event would happen and take a picture, and often it turned out, just trying to get the picture that I saw of that event.
Well, colonialisation is something that you do have clearly within all of your work that you've transcended, but also imagining the history. Sometimes the history that you research is not always so clear. Tell us about that.
You mean like the there's a bit of an ambiguous kind of, is that what you mean?
Yeah, I guess I'm privy to your work in the sense of how far you're going to research the stories that you've come across in terms of narratives and how they hold and perhaps undo themselves as well.
Yeah, completely. And there's a lot of they're stories. They're not literal histories of things. They're things that have been reported. And that's what I'm more interested in. I'm not as interested in the absolute specific facts of, I'll say, like, a Burton Wills. Although I love that story, just because of its hopelessness. But it's more of these ambiguous local histories from areas. I did a residency in Hillam last year, for example. And just all the research stories from there were just really strange, people living out on a river and being found lying on a path with their clothes neatly folded next to them, prone on the ground, face down, but dead, but no sign of any kind of violence or any kind of foul play. It was just that they just gone crazy, I think. And no one really explained anything. But the way they reported it was so strangely kind of mysterious, and they really delved into the kind of almost supernatural, what they thought were supernatural things happening, but really it's just a guy living out in the bush on his own, thinking that he could do that, but obviously he wouldn't. He's got to be nothing.
This darkness seems to creep within your work. You do like to sort of have a kind of mysteriousness and a kind of unknown about what it is that when you photograph your landscapes and your work in that regard. Is that a conscious thing?
Yes. Well, actually, yeah, it is. I mean, I'm drawn to that darkness thing. I don't know why, but it's just it's a product of the stories that I read as well. And the times that they happen are often, it's just all those sinister, not sinister, I don't like to use that word sinister actually, it's just those mysterious kind of weird happenings are often happening at odd hours, or early morning, late at night. So that's when I take those pictures, because that's when the events are reported. So it just happens that, there are those kind of weird sort of strange times. And that lends itself to being quite creepy in the imagery.
Well, we might sort of delve into perhaps how that affects you on a personal level. But, the characters seem to be something that, the absence of the characters within your images seems to be really present. So there is a mood. And there's also sort of an atmospheric charm. And maybe that's got something to do with the craft of how you use and take these pictures.
Yeah, well, I think going out into those areas, I do it on my own. I don't like going necessarily out with people. I think I actually enjoy being with the camera out in those areas. And as I said before, I've come to terms with this, but I think it is me just trying to understand my own confusion about my relationship with the land. And it was interesting hearing Adam talk before, and it really is that kind of, for me, it's that I need to know my places in these histories and in these landscapes that I'm drawn to, though I feel this kind of real, strange feeling from these places. So, but being alone helps that for some reason. I can deal with it, and having to take pictures and have things to do, little jobs and stuff like that. And concentrating on that scene just helps me.
So the discomfort, the edginess. Let's talk about the craft.